Well, to discuss this, we're joined here in the studio by Hadi Al-Bahra. He's a member of the opposition Syrian Negotiations Commission. In Berlin, we have Matthew Karnitschnig. He's the chief correspondent in Europe for Politico. In Grenoble, France, we have Francois Burgat, a member of the European Council on Foreign Relations. In Moscow is Sergey Markov, a political analyst and former Kremlin advisor. And finally, also with me here in the studio is the head of TRT Arabic, Resul Serdar. Gentlemen, I thank you very much for joining us on the Newsmakers. Hadi Al-Bahra, let me start with you. We had all these powers talking about Syrians, but no Syrians. So as a Syrian in opposition to Assad, as you watched what was unfolding on Saturday, did you feel something good came out of it?
I think we can call it a success. The summit could be named the summit of consensus, where the four countries successful in reaching major understanding and common point of interest, where they addressed objectively and they have reached a common plan to solving these issues. Some of them, like Russia, had to adjust its position, and especially on the refugees issues and reconstruction issues. Germany has addressed more strongly with Turkey about the political resolution of the crisis and the establishment of the constitutional committee. So by all standards, we can say, by words, by the closing statement, it's a successful consensus summit. But we will wait and see if we can transpose these words into actions on the ground in the near future.
Sergey Markov, we hear from Hadi Al-Bahra that Russia had to adjust some of its positions here in order to gain consensus. Do you agree with that, that Russia had to adjust more than the others had to adjust to Russia?
I think a lot of our colleagues believe that Russia has too much. I'm sorry. Maybe they, another country, has some more. For example, France and Germany should talk about the peace solution, political solution, few years before, but not just now. But let's move to the result of the summit. I think the main positive result is formation of political subject. Political actor, which is now these four, Turkey, Russia, France, and Germany. These four will play for the transmission Syria from the war to the peace. Previous period, most important role have been played by Troika, Russia, Turkey, and Iran, and their role was to finish the war, and they almost did it. Now this war will have role to start the peace.
They have been created. Okay, you're encouraged by it. Okay. Now let me bring in Resul Serdar. Resul, Turkey taking the lead here, inviting everybody to Istanbul after Saturday, after that final communique where we saw President Erdogan with the other leaders. Did it feel like it was a success that this is moving forward?
It is a success, but at the end of the day, we should remember that the Geneva talks, there has been 7-8 talks there, and it was not a successful. So many of the parties, related parties, were feeling that it is just a waste of the time. But starting with Astana and Sochi process, and now in Istanbul, a new summit that has been extended to the largest European actors as well, I think it's a success. Symbolically, it's a success as well. When you look at the ending result or the communique of the summit, you will see that mostly it is dominated by the narrative of Turkey and Russia. 85% was dominated by Russia and Turkey. First, the first stress on the national sovereignty, which was insisted by Russia, and the territorial integrity of Syria, which was a very much sensible issue for Turkey. It was a success. So France and Germany, in this case, we're here mostly for two reasons. First, humanitarian issues, mostly I will say refugees, because mostly Germany, but to a certain extent France as well, they have to tackle with this issue, because now they are the engines of the European Union. And the second reason for them of being here, or the importance of them being here, was, I will say, symbolically, it was important to extend the legitimacy of the summit. France and Germany had a huge contribution to this summit.
Okay, so Francois, we were here on Saturday watching it unfold, and we spoke about it afterwards. You've had some time to think about it now, a couple days on. Francois, what do you think? What was the main reason for Emmanuel Macron being here? Was it terrorism and stopping terrorism? Was it the refugee crisis, or was it extending French soft power and also adding legitimacy to the process?
Well, I saw three of them. I shall repeat the words of a French diplomat who said that before all, Francis wanted to be back in the game, mm-hmm. even with very weak cards. So France wanted to again participate in finding the solution. For which reasons? You have said it. One is the migrant dimension of the crisis. The second one, which has been very artificially the main one for the French and many European, is the so-called terrorism or extreme fringe of the Syrian crisis. So this is all part of this new step. Now, allow me to say why this has been a success before I will probably lower my optimism. It has been a success because it has upheld the agreement on Idlib. And Idlib, in the history, in the recent history of the crisis, it is the very first time that something else than a mere continuum in the military process is on the table. It is the first time that some politics is back in the tool, among the tools of the players. So for this reason, it is important. Now we will probably later on ask me if I am confident in the political solution. I am not. I will say it later.
Okay. Well, you've asked the question for me, and you're not confident. That's fascinating. Matthew Karnitschnig, we come to you on an interesting day because we've just got news, obviously, that Angela Merkel will be stepping down as party chairman of her party, the CDU, from 2021. It is certain that she will not be chancellor in Germany. A lot of people see the situation in Syria and its aftermath and the refugee crisis as having affected her deeply domestically. So let me then ask you, Matthew, was Angela Merkel in Istanbul for domestic or international purposes?
I think she was there for international purposes because she's been keeping a close eye on what's happening in Syria and particularly in Idlib recently. And this is exactly the kind of meeting, the kind of dialogue that Merkel likes to engage in internationally. She never shies away from meeting with world leaders in conflict zones. So I think this is very much in keeping with what has been her international policies since she's been chancellor. If you look at what she's done in the Ukraine, the Minsk agreements and so forth, it's very similar. Unfortunately, often these dialogue sessions that she engages in don't result really in tangible results. And I would also argue that this was such a case that even though some of your guests now are saying this was a success, I think it's very difficult to describe this as a success from a Syrian vantage point. It might be a success from some of the viewpoints from the various capitals engaged in the talks, but certainly from a European's perspective, it can't be seen as a success at all.
Okay, so Hadi al-Bahra, take Matthew up on that. He's saying from a Syrian perspective, it can't really be a success. And he has a point in the sense that, okay, while there might be a ceasefire in Idlib, things might be paused for the moment, and there's good intentions, we're seeing nothing tangible moving forward right now. Should we not expect any more than what was achieved this weekend?
No, we can say partly he's correct in his statement, but we need to consider that two major players in this summit, who are Russia and Turkey. Both of them, they have their forces on the ground in Syria. Both of them party to the agreement in Idlib. And both of them, they play a big role into the political solution of the crisis. So what we expect transferring these understanding and consensus reached by word in the closing statement into action in the upcoming meeting for the Astana group and later on with the small group in, which met today, I think, and coming out with the clear roadmap into implementation, the establishing of the Constitutional Committee, and reactivating the Geneva talks.
Do you think all these people can get together in a Constitutional Committee before the end of the year?
I think the committee would be established. I don't know if Russia would be able to press enough on the Syrian regime to let them have active participation in it. But at the end, the regime has no way except to participate in this committee.
Yeah, talking about Russia, Sergey Markov, when we watched that press conference, it ultimately looked like consensus among three countries for sure, with Russia very loosely connected to everybody else. And I give you some examples. When it comes to Vladimir Putin saying, don't call them a regime. It's rude. They are the legitimate government of Syria. We have Emmanuel Macron saying the regime wants to retake control of the country. That won't happen again. Angela Merkel talking about Assad's chemical weapons use against his own people. Russia believes it was the other side that did the chemical weapons attack. With all of that in mind, is it rather just Russia representing Assad and the Iranians and that other side versus everybody else? And pragmatically coming together because they want to stop the bloodshed?
I think Russia has an independent policy. Sometime it could be almost alone. But we don't have psychological problems because of this. We believe that sometime the right could be those who are alone, because another is crowd, which is under the pressure of some big chief connected with destabilization of situation. I think that was in the summit was some kind of bargaining and about what will happen in the post-war Syria. Turkey, France and Germany want to have political influence for the formation of the government of the post-war Syria. Russia wants them to pay for economical recovering of the, Syria. And the discussion will be continued in the next meetings. And we know that the foreign ministers of the, all these four countries will meet very briefly to discuss specific steps. And I think this will be the key percent. What is first? Political influence for them and money then, or first they should pay money for recovering, or how to make it parallel and in harmony. It will be the point for discussion.
Let me come in here for a second. I want to ask you if there has been a shift on one particular issue. Up until now, Russia has been very fluid in its definition of who is a terrorist and who is a legitimate target for both Russian forces and Bashar al-Assad's regime forces. In the final communique, it says very clearly that they all agree that Daesh or ISIS and Al-Qaeda-linked militants, Nusra Front or HTS, whatever you want to call them, they are condemned and legitimate targets for everybody. But before that, the Russians even included the pre-Syrian army and others as legitimate targets. Is this now a shift that Russia agrees with everybody else that, okay, Al-Qaeda and Daesh, fine, those are extremists, everybody else, they are legitimate rebels?
It's not exactly. I'm sorry. It's not like the student's answer on the exam about history, what already happened. Because those organizations, sometimes terrorist organizations can change their names, as, for example, Jabhat al-Nusra tried to do it. And at the same time, their behavior can be changed. Mm-hmm. Where, very clear, if they use military forces against civilians, if they they're terrorists, if they just fighting against soldiers, they're soldiers fighting for something else, and they we can negotiate with them.
Right.
Also, the ability to negotiate. We know that Daesh and Jabhat al-Nusra not able to negotiate. Other possibly can. And it's about Idlib.
Okay.
We come to agreement that from Idlib zone, it will be not military attack. Those military groups who follow this agreement, they're not terrorists. Those who violated this agreement and sent some of the bombs or use artillery from those period, they're terrorists.
Okay. Matthew, let me bring you in here and look at the German perspective here. No matter who's in charge in Germany, as we move forward, is there German appetite to get more involved in solving Syria? And is it on behalf of Germany or is it on behalf of the entire European Union?
Well, I think it would have to be an initiative, at least with France and representing the broader European Union. And that definitely seems to be the direction that German foreign policy is going generally. And on an issue as difficult as Syria, I think that the Germans would want to have as many other European countries on board with whatever they're doing there as possible. That said, I think that the German elites certainly recognize how important Syria is on the one hand. On the other hand, they also see that it's a very fraught, difficult situation, and there aren't any easy solutions. And this discussion here now about the Constitutional Committee, for example, there's no guarantee that that is actually going to happen or that it's going to produce any results. Just the opposite. It seems likely that that will not lead to anything, given the fact that Russia has little interest in having a real kind of constitution in Syria any more than Assad does. So this feels a little bit like a bit of a game, in particular on the part of the Russians, to kind of play for time and to negotiate to try and get a little bit of money out of the Europeans maybe for reconstruction. But anybody who believes that this is going to end in some kind of a real constitutional reform in Syria, as long as Assad and the regime there is in power, I think is somewhat naive.
Hadi, are the Russians and is Assad just playing for time here?
For sure, this is the main strategy, but also we have a real situation on the ground that you cannot have a stable Syria without reaching a political resolution of the crisis. You cannot have reconstruction without having stabilization. You cannot have the refugees returning back to Syria without a stable and free country. All of these facts have been understood now by Russia, which tried to bypass all these points, and it failed. Until now, very few refugees came back to Syria. No countries agreed to start reconstruction inside Syria. So the odds is that Russia and the regime would be forced to go into talks for a political resolution of the crisis.
Political resolution, which includes Bashar al-Assad still being the president of Syria, would that be acceptable?
I think the Syrian people have said their word. They have their revolution. They want a new government, new leaders, and new future for Syria.
And Resul, Serdar Atash, what is Turkey's end game here? What does Turkey want ultimately?
Basically, as I emphasized, Turkey's priority is the territorial integrity of Syria, which means basically it is a kind of policy against the PKK's offshoot YPG, because YPG now, for the long term, I think is the real strategic threat for the Syrian territorial integrity. Mm-hmm. And Turkey is giving a huge importance over that and to stop this. There are some real suspects, or I would say doubts, about the United States as well, United States Syrian over Syria as well, because some of the analysts and some of the policymakers also in Ankara, I think, are coming to a point to believe that the USA also for the long term is somehow planning a kind of federation in Syria, which will be a huge blow for Ankara. Mm-hmm. And I think Turkey, by focusing on this, by focusing on the territorial integrity of Syria, is basically trying to prevent this. Look, in Syrian scene, we have four real actors. All of the rest are, I will say, details. Turkey, Russia, Iran, and the USA. And everybody knows, at the end of the day, when there is a table for the solution, these four parties are going to be the leading forces.
Let's say goodbye now to Matthew, Francois, and Sergey, and bring in two new guests. We spoke about the Iranians and the Americans. From Milan, we have Michael Pregent. He's a senior fellow at the Hudson Institute. And from Tehran, we have Iranian affairs analyst Said Mustafa Hoshcheshim. Gentlemen, good to have you joining us on the Newsmakers. Michael Pregent, so
thank you for having me.
This weekend, the theory went, as far as the people I'd spoken to, the theory was that the U.S. is not invited and not involved right now partly because of their naivety when it came to Syria. And ultimately, this Daesh first or ISIS first policy meant that the U.S. had to play dumb about the geopolitics of the region and even sacrifice possibly its relationship with Turkey by going for this ISIS first policy by arming the YPG and so forth. Were the Americans left out because they just didn't get it anymore?
Well, I think we needed to develop a strategy. The Americans needed to have a strategy for Syria, And it's evolved, and it's actually went backwards, it's gone forwards. But this counter-ISIS strategy that's been the main focus in Turkey has been a problem, you're right. And one of the issues here is using the proxy forces to go into Sunni Arab areas. So using the YPG, the SDF, which is heavily commanded by the YPG, to go into a Sunni area such as Draka and Deir ez-Zor and not build up a Sunni Arab force. One of the things we did during the surge in Iraq is we built static Sunni security forces to not only help us decimate al-Qaeda, but to protect their neighborhoods from Iranian-backed Shia militias. So we need to do something like that in Syria. So our new strategy now is to maintain cleared areas of ISIS, to keep ISIS from coming back, and to defeat the remaining pockets of ISIS. And then we have this counter-Iran strategy that's highly dependent on Russia helping us move Iran out when we know Iran, correction, when we know Russia can't help us. So it looks like we are, we don't have a strategy at this time. And we weren't even involved in these talks. It was Germany, France, Turkey, and Russia. Or correction, yeah, Russia. And we weren't in it, and that's a problem. We need to be in the game. We need to be in the fight.
Okay. Mustafa Hoshchashim, was Iran hurt by the fact that they weren't invited, or was Russia a suitable enough representative to pass on the message to the Iranians, because the two are mostly on the same side in backing Assad?
Hello, and thanks for having me. Well, you know, as far as the issue of the refugees is concerned, the Europeans in Turkey are entitled to be concerned about developments in northwestern Syria, in Idlib, since any kind of development, positive or negative, could have repercussions for these countries. But deep down, I believe that the goal or objective pursued, especially by Ankara, has been reinvigorating its position by collecting support from the Europeans in its interactions with Iran and Russia under this the Astana talks. And when we speak of more support for Turkey in this regard, nothing could be more encouraging or could be a proper, better pretext than the refugee issue that could result from the Idlib situation. So I do believe that Turkey's main goal has been reinvigorating its, position with regard to Iran and Russia under the Astana talks, of course, because Turks have more differences with these two, while Iran and Russia share, admittedly, they share more interests and they see more threat. They share more threats in Syria.
Right.
Therefore, in order to start some new balance in interactions within the Astana talks, I believe Turkey sought to bring up more support, and that's why they invited the Russians, to have them alone in front of several European nations that could exert pressure on Moscow with regard to the Syrian fight.
Hadi al-Bahra, let me ask you, as a member of the Syrian opposition, explain the difference in how you see the Russian support of Assad versus the Iranian support of Assad, and who you could actually deal with.
I could say the Iranians support Assad as a person, and their relation is concentrated and built with Syria through al-Assad family. While the Russians, they support the regime, the ruling regime in Syria. They are deeply in depth inside the regime institution in Syria. So their relation to the regime, it's not personal, it's more institution-wise. So this is why we find the difference in positions between the Iranian positions toward the crisis and the Russian position of the crisis.
Mm-hmm. Resul Serdar, is Turkey fed up with the Americans?
I wouldn't say it's fed up with the Americans, but it's quite frustrated with the Americans, because as my colleague from the USA, he said that we need a strategy. I think Ankara now believes that the USA has a strategy, and the strategy is basically to shift in this, the region from the nation states to the federations, and which is very much dangerous for Turkey as well. So I wouldn't say the USA lacks a policy, but that is a kind of policy that is continuing on, and Turkey is very much frustrated about that. On the other hand, Turkey is well aware of that as well. Turkey's alliance with the USA, it has been decades that they are there, and they have fought together on different fronts globally. And Turkey is well aware of that. If the USA is not at the table, there will not be a real solution as well. So I think on one hand, Turkey is frustrated with the USA's policy, but on the other hand, it knows that the USA has to be there, a very much constructive part of the solution as well.
We know that the US president has a lot on his mind. There's midterms coming up. There was an attack in a synagogue. There's the migrant caravan that he's been talking about and even hyping and so on. Once all of that ends, do you think Trump and even Secretary Mattis and others would accept others sorting out Syria without the U.S. being fully involved?
Well, I think the last thing the president wants is to run in 2020 with ISIS resurgence in Iraq and Syria. So the U.S. is there to stay. It's whether or not the strategy expands. And now we have a counter-ISIS and counter-Iran strategy in Turkey. But one of the things we're looking at specifically is the return of refugees. And we know once you leave a country, it's roughly about 5% of refugees that ever want to come back. And one of the messages actually sent by the Air Force Director of Intelligence, Assad's Air Force Intelligence Director, said that there are 3.2 million Syrians on a terrorist list. And what that means is that there's 3 degrees of separation. So a father, son, and a grandson would be on this terrorist list as well. And it's a disincentive for refugees to come back to Syria. Now, one of the biggest things the United States has is its unshakable position not to pour money into areas that Iran, Russia, and Assad have destroyed. So Russia and Iran want reconstruction funds. They're not going to get them from the United States, and we're going to put pressure on our European allies not to provide that funding. One of the pawns that Russia, Iran, and Assad have are those 500,000 refugees in Syria, and that's one of the issues. Our biggest concern here is who's allowed to vote in an upcoming election that determines whether or not Assad stays. And what we're seeing now is that unless you're in Turkey, you're not going to be allowed to vote. Mm-hmm. And if you're one of the 6.1 million internally displaced Syrians, you will have to vote in the areas that you're from. And the regime, Iran and Russia, won't let you come back. So those are things we're looking at long term, but it's hard to look at those things and address them if you're not at the table, if you're not part of these meetings, and if you're relying on outside organizations that have not succeeded in the past to represent your positions.
Presumably, Mustafa Hoshchashem, the Iranians prefer for the Americans not to be at the table?
Let me explain something in brief first. You know, as was mentioned in the program, there are now some small numbers of refugees that have started reverse flow and reverse, you know, they are coming back to the country from Europe to Turkey and Syria, and also from Lebanon to Syria. This happened after several years of fighting and victories for the Syrian army and its allies on the ground, and after they could prevail sovereignty over major population centers in the country except for Idlib. This shows us that once terrorism is uprooted and stability or relevant security and stability prevails over the country, then we could see the refugees coming back to the country. This should be done in Idlib as well. According to the Sochi agreement, the first major or the first phase of the military objectives was establishing a demilitarized zone in Idlib. And this major goal has been in trouble right now, according to dissident-affiliated reports like Syrian Observatory of Human Rights and others. There are daily reports stressing that internationally recognized terrorist groups like al-Nusra, they have reinvigorated themselves in this demilitarized zone, and they are even launching attacks on Syrian army positions. Now, it's time for Turkey, I believe, to initiate a new strategy within the whole Syria and not just Idlib. I believe Turkey needs to take a new step in order to strike a new deal or agreement with Iran and Russia, in order to uproot the issue of the problem of terrorism, helping the Syrian army to do what has been mentioned in the Sochi agreement,
but that's so far,
establishing the demilitarized zone.
Turkey
and its allied militants could fight the al-Nusra in that zone.
On the weekend was that, despite some problems, the Idlib agreement is holding. What they agreed on in Sochi is holding, yes, despite some problems. So
it's holding, but the Russians are already making the statement that right. They need to separate the 10,000 designated terrorists, Jabhat al-Nusra and other groups, from the civilian right. population. And if they don't separate, then Russia is going to start conducting military operations.
Right.
What's key here is that Turkey actually has military on the ground. And Russia is not willing to attack targets where they're actually putting Turkish troops in danger.
Right.
So that is the wild card there. That's the pawn. But Russia's signaling okay. that unless Jabhat al-Nusra somehow removes itself from the population, that it's willing to conduct military operations.
Yep.
And that's not going to happen.
Yep. Big question marks over HTS or Jabhat al-Nusra. For the moment, Idlib holds, and people are seeing it as a microcosm of how things can be better in the rest of the country. A lot at stake. War still rages for 7.5 years in Syria. Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure talking to all of you. I have to move on, but I thank you all, Hadi, Resul, Mustafa, and Michael. Thanks again.